many of you must be knowing this, but just it's a refresher course, so we're just revising everything. Okay, so I'll just share my screen. Okay, the PPT is visible.
Yes, sir.
E-content developer.
I was थोड़ा सा मोटे नहीं, so can you okay. speak louder?
Okay, better.
Now it is better, sir.
Okay, so e-content development. What is e-content? Basically, it includes all kinds of content created and delivered through various electronic media. So creating and delivering. So maybe you have created physically, like we take a lecture in a classroom, is created not on e-platform, but once you record and you can deliver it. That becomes a electronic media. So what we are doing in the for this paperwork also, sometimes we just scan and convert the handwritten paper into a PDF. So created manually, but you convert it into a digital media. It becomes e-content. Technology-based e-learning encompasses the use of internet and other important technologies to produce material for learning, to teach learners, and also to regulate courses in an organization. So it is for students also, for teachers also. And also for the administrative staff. So this is a very interesting pyramid, learning pyramid. So if you look student perspective, the average student retention rate is least with what you used to do before. That is the lecture. Delivering a lecture is absorbed only 5% by the student. If you tell them to read, maybe 10% is absorbed. With an audio-visual interaction, 20% is retained. What we teach. If you give a demonstration one-to-one, 30% mutual discussion, you are answering, then the student is answering, you are asking, then he is asking. So that discussion will retain 50% of the knowledge. Practice doing it either on the model or on the mannequins or on the patient will retain 75%, and teaching others will be the 90%. So we as teachers, we are still students. So our retention rate is 90% what we read, because we don't know what is the student going to ask in the lecture. So we read something extra. We go to the depths of the point. If there is some word, we try to find out the meaning of that word. So if somebody in the class will stand up and ask, sir, what is the meaning of this word? We should not remain blank. So teaching is again a part of learning, and in that 90% retention is there. That is why we have in the syllabus that students should also give some lectures. So they learn that way. So in short, we'll just see 11 types of e-learning contents. The first is the most common. What we are doing now is PowerPoint presentation. Most popular form, easy to put together, and ideal for laying out information in a style most are used to seeing. You can also incorporate then other contents into that presentation, like putting a video into a PPT, putting a poll within a PPT, putting a quiz into the PPT, so that can be combined. A basic format will be PPT. Second will be webinar. When in-person training isn't possible, one-to-one is not possible, webinars can be a great substitute. It can be used specifically indicated for a large audience, 50, 100, 200, 300, or over a large geographical distribution, maybe all over India or all over world. Then we have case studies. In case studies, the examples are extremely helpful, and what better way to include real life examples than through case studies. So for PGs, what we have case presentation, that is the best way to learn how the case was managed and then discuss around that. So other than presentation, we can have this a PDF format, a simple screen, or we can have a photographic collage that can be stored as a e-content format. Then we have slide based courses. They involve the user taking a self-paced course where learners view slides with interactive units and possibly narrations and other multimedia elements. Such courses often have a look and feel similar to PowerPoint, and then basically an offline training converted into online format. So during lockdown, what many of us have done some courses on your Facebook or some other platforms, those recorded PowerPoints, recorded courses, and accessible freely. So whenever anybody available, you can just go see the presentation and learn from that. Then one But this quiz, you can call it test, you can call it assessment, or you can call it knowledge checks. It's an essential component of e-learning that allows you to track your learner's knowledge and ensure the learning objectives of your training are being met. Like in this presentation, after these slides are over, we'll take a quiz. So I'll be able to know that whether you have understood the concept, whether you understood the types of e-content what you have discussed. During one or two lectures also, I've used it. One was for parental ligament, one was for treatment planning in periodontics. Students enjoyed it a lot. They are also fun and interactive way to break up the content into small segments and assess at each level before proceeding further. So if the lecture is too long, maybe you're having 70, 80 slides of a presentation. So instead of doing 70 slides and then taking one quiz, you can divide it after every 10 slides, every 12 slides, or after a short segment of that presentation, you can have a quiz that will just free the mind. Then continue with 10-15 slides, then again take a quiz. So it will keep the interest maintained for the students. Then you have training videos. A video content is more popular than ever, and with good reason. Why? Because it's always more engaging than text or pictures alone. Ways to use the videos. One is a standalone video. Means what? It is recorded like we see YouTube videos. There is some technique how to make a particular thing which have been recorded maybe 6 months, 1 year, 2 years back. But anytime we can see, just understand the video and we can try to recreate it. That is a standalone video. One is an embedded video. Means as I am talking now, as the presentation is going on, there is a small video going on the side. And I can just keep on explaining what is happening in that video. That is an embedded video. But that will require my physical presence, a presenter's presence. In a standalone video, you need not require. You can just record it and you can leave it. Live training playback is again, you train for particular demonstration. You train how to use an instrument. You train how to do a surgery. And then it can be played back. Different types of video. There are how-to videos. How-to videos will include all the techniques and materials on how to perform a particular thing. How to do a surgery, how to make food, how to make a presentation, something like that. Then you have presenter screencast. Presenter screencast is again a combination of two videos. The presenter is having one video and the other window is showing the video of the technique or procedure. So both the videos are simultaneously projected and he can keep on explaining parallel. Then you have software tutorials. Software tutorial is something like what Meenakshi madam showed about Google Classroom. So she opened it, she had to open how to make it, how to edit it. So it was a live tutorial on how to use a particular software. That is called a software tutorial video. Then we have podcast. An episodic series of spoken word digital audio files that a user can download to a personal device for easy listening. Now, songs may not directly be into that, but you can have, say, some recording is there. Sometimes there is a interaction between two persons. We get on WhatsApp an audio and we listen to that audio. So two people are talking and we are just listening. So that is a type of podcast file which can be heard. It is a great non-accessible training, particularly skills that revolve around mindset, motivation, and other soft skills. So we have a lot of motivational videos on YouTube. So instead of looking, if we just listen, it becomes like a podcast. Now, this is very interesting, which can incorporate it in many clinics. Dialogue simulations. It is an e-learning content type that simulates a real-world conversation with a patient or any other third party. It's great for teaching practice etiquettes, consulting skills, and any type of training scenario that involves the need for conversation between two parties to establish facts, negotiate, and reach mutually beneficial conclusions in a risk-free environment. Now, why it is important? As we know, whatever crime is happening, or you can say attack is happening on hospitals and clinics, may not be because of the improper treatment. It is because of the improper communication between the patient and doctor, improper rapport between the patient and doctor. So that is where it is lacking, is the point of view of many people. So at this level, if you can train the students how to talk to patient, when the patient come, how to greet him, asking few basic questions, how is he, has he had food, how is his travel, so it makes the patient feel comfortable. So all these things may not be able to teach each and every student with every new patient. So we can have a dialogue simulation recorded, and you can just send the files either via Google Classroom or during a class or on WhatsApp. So students can listen and understand how is the communication going between the doctor and patient. If the patient is complaining for some treatment done or is complaining about some charges or something, how the clinician is handling that in a polite way, convincing the patient. So that need not be learned directly when they go to the clinics. That can be taught with dialogue simulations so that they will have a background how to go ahead with it. A lot of time when we call a customer care of any particular software, what is the first sentence? This call is being recorded for quality and training purposes. So it has been done actually at corporate levels many places. It is just to be incorporated in medicine dentistry so that we can take the best advantage of it. Then another content is ebooks, very common. Most of the time PDF books are available, lot of PDF books are there, and it's a very quick and easy way to share things, SOPs. There are some step-by-step procedure for something or other manuals with your students or staff and provide a good reading experience. It is a great option if you have some materials sitting around in Word or PDF format, which is underutilized or simply not available to learners in a format that is easy to access and consume. For example, we have some books in the library on instruments, types of instrument, types of mouth mirror, types of probe, types of tweezer. These are simple things. But when you ask students, they don't know. They might not be knowing that there is a book somewhere in the library which shows all these things. So if you can make an ebook of it and just circulate that material, it will be accessible and they might know some more things. Just an example. Now this is one content, it's called interactive videos. In normal training videos, learners passively or lack of engagement can become a drawback, major drawback. What madam was telling, when we deliver lecture in the classroom, we don't know whether the student is there at the other end. We are just speaking and talking and there is no response. There's one CR or someone student who has to respond, so he's always alive, otherwise rest are all not there. So interactive video will correct that drawback. Now technology now enables us to provide interactions with videos such as hotspots and quizzes. This could be a good choice if you want to add the ability for users to click, drag, scroll, hover, gesture, or complete other digital actions to interact with the video's content. Now we have virtual reality and augmented reality. This could be a new age technology, some advanced software. Maybe we at near future, we may not be directly able to use it, but it is still there. Maybe in future, if it's possible, we can incorporate that in our college or in our practice. It is great for training both human interactions and practical training in real world physical scenarios. Simulations allow you to replicate real life scenarios and practice the best way to react in those situations. Okay, so that was for the presentation. Now let's play a quiz. I'll share a link in the chat box. You can just click on the chat box, you will connect there. Just a second. I'll share the link in 1 minute. I'll stop sharing this presentation, then I'll put a link in the chat. Okay. The link is posted in the chat. You just have to click on that link and you will be directed to another website, quiz.com. So go there, you just have to click join or start. So here I'll get to know the actual attendance. When I played it for one of my lecture, actual lecture attendance was 95, and in the quiz only 35 students came. So then I knew that only these 35 people are actually attentive or there in the lecture. It's a good way to interact. So 19 still coming. We have 69 participants. When we'll cross 50, then we'll start the quiz. Simple quiz, don't worry about the answers. I just wanted to see how it works. There are different formats. One question is related to poll, one is like a fill in the blank word, one word, one is open question that you have to put your opinion in one, two words, one sentence. Few MCQs. Just 8 to 10 questions, just to get a hang of it, different types of questions. Mona madam is going to talk more about this interactive type of sessions, about quizzes and puzzles. This is one of example. So 30. Few more and we'll start. If not able to find chat column, it is if you're using mobile, it is in the lower left corner. The symbol of envelope or something. Posted the link again if somebody has not got it. Questions you won't be able to see now. I've not started yet. Okay, the ones sufficient people are there, then we'll start. As of now, you'll just see that it is start. Questions are not seen. Okay, no problem. We'll start now because time will be less. I'll click start. You can just start. The pyramid is not visible. You can click on the image. It will enlarge. Almost everybody has finished 80%. We'll wait for 2 minutes and then we'll end the game. Okay, I'll end the game now. First, Priya Desai. Second, Ashish. Third, Pustaka, sir. Nice.
What happened, Amit?
Game. I ended the game.
Okay.
Because many people were left, but then we had limited time. Now I'll just share the screen and I'll show where it is done and how it is done. Okay. So this is the finals. We can say leaderboard, first, second, third. Okay. So it's a great way to entertain and evaluate the lecture. So for a longer lecture, it is good to have multiple sessions of like this in after every 10 to 15 slides. So this is basically a website, quiz.com. So there are already many recorded quizzes available on different topics, dental, non-dental, general, for small kids. So you can help your kids also to use it and learn about different topics. It could be about atmosphere, temperature, animals, anything. Okay. So once you log in, you have your own username, password. So you can make activities, you can create. So this I've created this few quizzes about treatment plan, parental ligament, and this e-content. Okay. So you just have to do is create, and then when you start creating, how you make your MCQs on Google Form, your quizzes on Google Form, you can just keep adding one questions, you can add images and all that. So we have 2-3 more things to do. So I won't go into detail of that. Once you log into this quiz.com and you click create, the rest is all easy to understand. Okay. So I'll cross this now and I'll show you another thing now. Okay. I'll share the window where we'll see how you can make a PDF from PPT. How to make a PowerPoint, I won't talk much on that because we already know how to make a PowerPoint. This is basically PowerPoint. I've made this for a case presentation. Now for PG, especially when we tell them to keep your PowerPoints, your case presentations as a PDF file, they normally keep it as a PowerPoint, but we don't access it that much. So instead of keeping it or storing it as a PPT, we can store it in the PDF format. So with the e-content focusing on so much, we'll have lot of data that has to be saved on the disk in the computer. So very much heavy files will use up the space also. So we don't just want to create e-content, but we want to store it in a least occupiable sizes. So a PPT will store more size, a PDF will store a very less space. So whatever PPTs can be converted to a PDF form and then stored it. So that will be a much easier way to store more files in a limited area. So here, I just posted an image, enlarge it, put some text, whatever you want to highlight it. Here I put a name, and then all slides you can just arrange like that, for figures and text. After that, just click file, save as. wherever you want to save, maybe it is in document. And here when the option comes, instead of save as PPT, you can select a PDF. So this option of PDF might not be available in all the versions of Microsoft Office in PowerPoints. Older versions in this PDF option won't be seen. So first you can go to Google, the software convert PPT to PDF, and you can upload online and you can download from there. But in the newer versions, you can directly have these options. It becomes very easy to save. Save as PDF and it is done. Even Word document, when normally we have to convert it to PDF, what we do, we upload it on the Google and then download it from there. So Word document also, if you do like this, save as, and instead of Word, select PDF, in a second it converts to PDF. Okay, nothing much to show in this. PowerPoint presentation could be of any format, doesn't matter. Next, I'll show animation and convert it to video. This is again just a regular PPT which was first made, and in that then I've added animation. Now in this, what animation can be seen if we make it full screen? Sorry. So this is coming automatically. It is all animations are timed back to back, so it looks like a animation. So here you can just, this is a separate line, this is a separate rectangle, and in the animations, what we have done is wipe option is selected, so it shows wipe, and you can give the speed, you can give it delay, so that you can have a slow movement. You can delay. We'll see. There's this delay in starting the animation like that. So understanding how to make a PPT and how to add animations in that will be maybe a separate webinar will be required. I am just showing one or two few here in this centrifuge. I have used the animation of spin. So as you make it enlarge, it will just start spinning. Okay, and in the options you can select spin for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, or keep on spinning until I click next slide, so like that. So once this all animation is there done, now what we have to do is time them. Now some slide will require more time, some slide will require less time. So if you directly save this file as save as video, it will keep equal time for all the slides, and it will be difficult for the reader to read one part and before it goes to the next. So what we'll do, we'll click here review, sorry, we'll click the slideshow, and here we'll click rehearse time on the top. So when you click rehearse time on the upper left, you can see timer has started. So as per your convenience, you decide how much time you have to give to one slide. Read yourself all the text so that whatever time you are giving now will be saved in the background, and when you will save it as a video, it will have the same timings. Okay, done. We won't go through all the slides. So once that rehearse timing is done, you are okay with it, that okay, all the slides have been given sufficient time. Just click on file again, save it folder, and here save as type. Last time we did PDF, here we'll save as MPEG4 or Windows Media Video also okay, but MPEG4 is more easy to distribute. You can send it on WhatsApp, you can send it on email. Video Windows Media File Video, if you store, it is difficult to share. That format is not followed for all the devices, so MPEG4 will be a better option, and just click save. It will save as a video format of it. Okay, so not too much in detail, just to give you a highlight. You start making it if there is some any confusion, if you're not able to understand something, I'm always there in the department. So I'll hand over to Mona Madam now. Thank you so much. हेलो पुस्तक सर रेखा मैम
ओके थैंक यू वेरी मच सर
थैंक यू सर माय प्लेजर
इट वाज अ वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन एंड वेरी रियली इंटरैक्टिव प्रेजेंटेशन इट वाज थैंक्स अ लॉट
थैंक यू
आई होप वी ऑल वुड बी एबल टू मेक यूज ऑफ द इंफॉर्मेशन गिवन बाय यू एंड मेक टीचिंग more enjoyable for the students as well as for us
hello everyone
I request dr mona to please start her presentation Yes, ma'am.
So, shall I start?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. First of all, I thank our principal, Dr. Meenal Guve, ma'am, coordinator, Dr. Pradeep Jail, sir, Bhushan Pustake, sir. And I also thank all the members of IQAC cell and MIT cell for giving me the opportunity to be here and share my knowledge about the development of e-content and use of the e-resources. Actually, much